Hello, my name is Bill Dallas, and I'd like to welcome you to today's CCN Satellite broadcast. We're broadcasting from our studios here in Northern California, and we're going to churches all across North America. That's Canada, the United States, and the Bahamas. Today's program is called Every Young Woman's Battle, and our speaker is Shannon Etheridge. Let me tell you a little bit about Shannon. She's the author of numerous books, including Every Young Woman's Battle and Every Woman's Battle. Would you please join me in welcoming Shannon Etheridge.
Thanks for having me back.
Shannon, thank you for being back. And you know what I forgot to mention also? You're a wife and mother, mm-hmm. and you're an advocate for sexual purity. Mm-hmm. I know you speak to a lot of teenagers and young adults all around the country. And this it's interesting, you talk about battle. Is it really a battle going on out there?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's been a battle all along, but it's really intensified just over the past few years, especially for young women, because I think they're being taught that they should be the pursuers, and they've actually become more predatory than many young men. And so I think that it is definitely time for a victory message for young women engaged in these battles.
And when you speak to young women, Do you find that they're receptive? I mean, do they want to hear this or?
Absolutely. I mean, it's just amazing how their brains are like sponges and they just soak all of this up, and they're so relieved that someone is willing to talk to them about these internal struggles that they haven't even had the courage to verbalize, even, you know, oftentimes to their friends. So it's very refreshing just to see the candid responses from them and just saying, thank God somebody's, you know, finally talking about this with them.
Well, you've got an audience both here and all across North America that's interested to hear what you have to say. So I'll be back later.
Thanks, Bill. I appreciate it. Well, people often ask me, why are you so passionate about sexual integrity that you would dedicate your entire life and your entire ministry to teaching abstinence until marriage and teaching sexual fulfillment within marriage? And I have to be honest with them. I tell them, it's because I have AIDS, visual AIDS, and I want to show those to you right now. So if we could have the pictures of my family, and when I explain my personal testimony, you will know that it is really a miracle that I don't have AIDS. This is my husband and I on our wedding day almost 16 years ago. And this is a more recent family photo of my daughter, including my daughter who's 13 and my son who is 10. But in all honesty, we almost didn't make it to that day of that family portrait being made. Because it was 7 years into my marriage that I approached my husband saying, you just don't meet my emotional needs. And I was actually thinking of leaving him and my two very young children. Aaron was 3 and Matthew was a newborn at the time. But I was thinking of leaving in pursuit of the love that I felt entitled to, that I just didn't feel as if I was getting from my husband. And so when I approached him singing this You Don't Meet My Emotional Needs song, he saw past my weaknesses to my needs. And he said to me, Shannon, you have a grand canyon of emotional needs. And even if every man in Dallas lined up outside your doorstep to spend time with you, it wouldn't be enough. He said, until you look to God to satisfy your emotional needs, there is nothing that I nor any other man on the planet can do to satisfy you. And while many women would be very offended by those kinds of words, I was actually very relieved because it gave me a sense of hope. I thought, wait a minute, there's a way to get these emotional needs fulfilled by God? And yet that rang so true in my spirit because I had been very promiscuous as a teenage girl, and I had given lots and lots of men opportunities to meet my emotional needs, and no man ever lived up to that expectation. But the idea that God could do that was very refreshing to me, but I didn't know how to make that happen. And so I went through 6 months of very intensive individual and group counseling to try to get to the root of my lack of sexual boundaries and understanding this grand canyon of emotional needs that I had created for myself. And most of all, to understand how I could stop looking at God as just this, some distant heavenly being who was watching every move that I made, and embrace Him not only as a heavenly Father, but as the genuine lover of my soul. I had just never heard that term growing up. And so I came to understand that there were many events that happened in my life that probably led me to creating this grand canyon of emotional needs for myself. I'd like to share those with you because I feel as if many women can relate to several of the things that have happened in my life and maybe can understand why they have been digging a grand canyon for their emotional needs as well. First of all, when I was 4 years old, I had an 8-year-old sister and a 10-year-old brother. And one day, very suddenly, my sister died of an aneurysm. And I was the baby of the family, and the response of everyone in our family was just kind of to emotionally shut down. I didn't really understand what was going on at 4 years old, but my mother, she retreated to the kitchen. My father, he retreated out to his shop, and my brother, he retreated to his room. And that kind of left me in the living room going, hey, what about me? I was just so used to being the center of attention. And then all of a sudden, everybody was ignoring everybody else just out of their emotional pain. And then several years later, between the ages of about 10 and 13, I had several uncles in my family who proceeded to teach me that if I really wanted attention and affection, especially from men, that I could get that by playing this little flirtation game with them. The kind of games like, how far have you gone with a boy yet? And can I touch you here? Or, let's just have this be just between the two of us. This will just be our little secret kind of a thing. I found out later that my uncles actually had a bet going on amongst them as to who would get Shannon in bed first. And when I heard that, I thought, again, well, that didn't even affect me. I was thinking because they didn't succeed in having sex with me, it didn't affect me. I had no idea that the way that they trained me to pursue attention and affection in very unhealthy ways through flirting and using my sexual seductivity or whatever, that was very destructive in my life. As a matter of fact, when I was 14, I put myself in the wrong place at the wrong time with the wrong person. He was an 18-year-old star of the football team. There I was, 14, not believing that he was even looking my way. But when he asked if he could come over to my aunt and uncle's apartment the next day where I would be staying by myself, I thought, wow, I can't believe he wants to spend time with me. And so without even thinking, I said, sure, come on over. And so that particular day, I found out that there are some young men on the planet who have more than just flirting in mind. And I found myself in a date rape situation. But I felt as if I had flirted myself into this corner and I had to live up to the expectation. In hindsight, I could have ran, I could have screamed, I could have hit him, I could have done anything to get out of that situation. But like so many young women do, I passively chose to allow myself to be abused in that way. And so then when I was allowed to start dating at age 15, which in hindsight was way too young. My parents just didn't understand the deep level of immaturity that was going on in my life at that time, or the pain that I was operating out of. But when I was allowed to start dating, I thought that sex was the price that I had to pay in order to get the attention and the affection that I craved. And from 15 years old to about 20 years old, my life was just kind of one relationship after another, and if I had to pay sex as the price to get attention and affection, I usually didn't put up much of a fight. If I didn't have to, hallelujah, but just so often it was an expectation, and I just continued to give that away freely, feeling as if that gift is no longer precious enough to try to cherish or save. Now, thank God I had a big wake-up call when I was 20 years old. In the place that I had that wake-up call may sound really odd, but it was in the embalming room at a funeral home where I was working as a mortician. I grew up watching the show Quincy, and I wanted to be a medical examiner just like Jack Klugman, but I couldn't afford medical school. So I thought, well, being a mortician, that'd be the next best thing. And so I became an embalmer and worked at one of the largest funeral homes in Dallas. And we sometimes within 24 hours would embalm 24 bodies. I mean, we were just embalming one after another. And when I started mortuary college, I expected that all these people that I would be embalming would be like in their 80s or early 90s, and they would just die of natural causes. I was shocked at how many people were in their 20s or early 30s who had either died because of full-blown AIDS or had committed suicide because of an HIV-positive diagnosis. And I remember standing over the embalming table thinking, oh, there but for the grace of God go I. And I remember one time even asking God in prayer, Lord, why did you save me? I mean, as promiscuous of a lifestyle as I have had, I should have wound up on that embalming table. And one day I really sensed God say, Shannon, if you will trust me and follow me and turn your life around, allow me to turn your life around for you, I'm going to redeem your past. And I had no idea what redeeming my past meant, but I knew that I could not keep living the lifestyle that I had been living, that it was far too dangerous, not just physically, but also mentally and emotionally and spiritually. I was tired. I was exhausted from looking for love in all the wrong places. I knew I needed to get my life back together. And so I started going to the church down the street. I had fallen away from church as a college student. So I started going to the church, and within a short amount of time, met a great guy, 6'7". His name is Greg, and we became fast friends, and then we began dating after a while. And when Greg proceeded to proclaim to me that he was a 26-year-old virgin, I thought, well, it's been nice knowing you, because you're not going to want to keep dating a girl like me. And a few days later, I called him from the funeral home late one night while I was working, and I said, look, you need to understand what you're getting yourself into, and I can't continue this relationship without knowing that I've been honest with you. That you know, if you and I were to get married, I definitely would not be a virgin on our honeymoon night. And he said, well, Shannon, just based on some things that you had said, I had kind of already figured that out. And I said, but Greg, you don't understand. There's been more than just a guy or two. That there's been many partners, and I'm not proud of that, but you really do deserve to know what you're getting yourself into. And if you want to hang up the phone, I completely understand. I don't have any expectations from you at this point. And he said, Shannon, I don't love you because of your past. I love you because of who you are now and who God made you to be. And I want to help you become who God made you to be. And I thought, whoa, who is this guy? You know, of course, there was no question in my mind. I'm going to marry him. And I thought that being faithful to him would be absolutely no problem. However, just those few years into our marriage, what I learned was that putting this wedding band on my finger didn't change anything except my last name. I had never really studied how I interact with men and where I get my self-esteem from, and never examined my lack of sexual and emotional boundaries and all of those habits that I had created for myself as a single person. I took right on into marriage, and it wasn't long before I started feeling this overwhelming emotional temptation to connect with these men. And sometimes, you know, I would fear that it would even turn into a sexual relationship, but I would confess to my husband, I'm so sorry. I feel like I'm already having an affair, and this is so not fair to you. And thankfully, Greg would always say, I know that this is not about me and you. And he would say, I know that this is about you and your dad. And I used to think, well, now that's really weird. Why would you think this is about me and my dad? But it is true. When I traced that route all the way back, I recognized it was all the attention and the affection that I missed from my emotionally distanced father that I was still craving for as an adult woman. And so that's what led me into counseling, to get to the root of all of these things. And again, went through 6 months of really intense counseling to understand the myths that had always been operating in my mind and the truth that would set me free to live a life of sexual integrity and obedience to God. Now, as you're hearing about all these dark things from my past, you may be thinking, well, she must have been a really messed up girl, probably from a broken home or something. Well, no, my parents are still faithfully married to each other to this day, so the broken home wasn't an issue. Well, maybe she just was raised on the wrong side of the tracks. No, I was raised in rural Northeast Texas out in the country where safety wasn't really an issue, so it wasn't like I was in some kind of gang or something. So maybe you're thinking, well, maybe she was just dumb. No. I made straight A's. I was in the National Honor Society. I was the first person from my family to go to college and actually graduate. So you're thinking, yeah, but she wasn't a Christian back then. Yes, I was. I was raised in the church. My mother took me every week, and I confirmed my belief in Jesus Christ at age 12. And I was the president of my youth group. And I remember going to all these Christian concerts and woo-woo, just being on fire for the Lord. And then I would go sleep with my boyfriend that brought me to the concert. I was just living this total double life, not even realizing how unhealthy and how dysfunctional and how sinful all of this behavior was, until I got married and tried to change and realized that I need help in changing the way that I relate with men. And so I want to share with you the most basic truth that I learned during all these months of counseling, and that is that your sexuality is not just about what you do. It's about who you are as a human being. And God didn't make you just with a body. He made you with a mind, a body, a heart, and a soul. And we can't just stay out of bed with somebody and feel as if we're living a life of sexual integrity. We have to guard not just our bodies, but also our minds and our hearts and our spirits in order to truly live a life of complete sexual integrity. I want to share a couple of analogies that I have found very helpful just in trying to live my own life of sexual integrity. One is a folding table. If you could imagine a folding table, all four legs of that table have to be very secure in order for it to support any real weight, in order to remain balanced, right? Well, a friend of mine, she learned what would happen if one of the legs of that table wasn't securely fastened, and she learned this lesson at her wedding reception. She walked into the reception hall from the ceremony, and they had the five-layer cake right there on the table with the crystal punch bowls and the monogram frou-frou napkins and everything. And someone stepped forward to pour the red punch into the punch bowl. And it was at that moment that they discovered that one of those legs was not securely fastened. And all of a sudden, that table, pew, became a slide, and the cake, the punch, the napkins, everything just slid right off into the floor with a huge clatter. And everybody was horrified, and they looked to the bride with wide eyes, wondering what she would say and how she would respond. Fortunately, Ruth, having the sense of humor that she has, went, just started laughing hysterically, and everyone else laughed hysterically. It was a big party, cleaning it all up. Got some great pictures of that. But it's not such a laughing matter when one of the legs of our sexuality buckles and our life becomes not level, not balanced, but a slippery slope into the pit of sexual compromise. That is when her whole life comes unwound, and possibly when she loses her marriage and her children, as 50% of marriages do end in divorce today. And oftentimes the reason is because of sexual or emotional infidelity. And it's not always the men cheating. That actually today, the rates of female infidelity are just as high as the rates of male infidelity. So we've got to stop pointing our fingers at the men and start pointing back to ourselves and going, what can I do to make sure that I am living a life of sexual integrity? Another analogy is a car analogy. If you can imagine if someone were chasing you with the intent of harming you, and you're going to use a four-door car to take refuge and to be safe from this perpetrator, what is the first thing you're going to do when you get into that car? You're going to lock the doors, right? But how many doors are you going to lock? Are you going to lock one? Two? Three? No, you're going to lock all four. You are not safe until all four of those doors are locked, and there is no point of entry through which a perpetrator could attack you. And the same thing is true with our sexuality. As long as there is one component, mind, body, heart, or soul, that is left unlocked, you are vulnerable to Satan's attack. And Satan loves to use sexuality against God's people. As a matter of fact, in the book of Genesis alone, Satan distorted sexuality seven different ways. And it's still one of the favorite things he uses to just bring the whole church, the whole family, and individuals down. And we have got to guard against that. And so I want to go over a questionnaire that's taken from Every Young Woman's Battle. It's entitled, Are You Engaged in a Battle for Sexual Integrity? And the reason I think it's important for us to answer these questions, to look at them together, is because many young women assume, well, that's not my battle. That's not really my battle. As a matter of fact, when I was writing Every Woman's Battle, many women would ask me, oh, well, what is every woman's battle? I know about every man's battle, that's about sexual temptation, but what is every man's battle or every woman's battle? And I was like, well, duh. I said, well, it's about sexual, integrity. And they would say, oh, well, that's not really my battle. I thought maybe it was about shopping or eating. But then when they read this questionnaire, they go, maybe this was a bigger battle than I realized. And so I want to awaken you that if this is a personal battle for you, maybe you will recognize that in answering these questions together. And there's a yes or no place to circle, but by all means, if you don't feel comfortable doing that with the audience, the person next to you looking on, don't circle it here. Just, mentally process these, and maybe you want to circle them when you get home. But the first one is, do you watch television shows or movies with sexual jokes or graphic sex scenes? And maybe you're thinking, well, gee, it's kind of hard not to find movies, you know, with all of that in there. Well, they are to be had. But if you're just unscrewing your head and letting the world fill you with all these things in the from the television and from movies, then that's a battle right there. Number two, does the music you listen to talk blatantly of sexual desires outside of marriage? Number three, do you ever act overly friendly or even seductively to get a guy's attention? Number four, do thoughts of having or keeping a boyfriend consume your mind to the point that you find it difficult to concentrate on anything else for any length of time? If you're obsessing over your boyfriend, then that's a battle. Number five, are you looking for or entertaining the idea of a serious romantic relationship, even though it will be several years before you're ready to get married? Number six, do you habitually masturbate to pleasure yourself sexually or as a means of resisting sexual involvement with others? And for those of you who are just now hearing the term masturbation for the first time, it basically means touching your own genital area in order to arouse yourself sexually. It teaches you how to be a very selfish lover. And if you're doing that as a means of resisting sexual involvement with others, obviously you have a battle going on, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. Number seven, do you consider oral sex or other sexual activities okay because they're not vaginal sex and you can't get pregnant from it? This whole mentality of, well, I'm a virgin because I've never had intercourse, we'll talk about that in a minute too. Number eight, do you feel that your virginity has been stolen from you, like I did when I was growing up? Number nine, do you feel as if you are damaged goods that a respectable guy probably wouldn't want? Again, I can identify with you if that's how you feel. Number 10, do you believe it is ever okay for a couple to live together even though they are not married? That is also a battle of values if you're a Christian. Number 11, do you believe it is ever okay for a couple to have sex before they are married? Number 12, have you ever lied to your parents about where you were going or whom you were with because you knew they wouldn't approve if you told the truth? Number 13, would you lie to your parents in order to go out with a particular guy that you liked a lot if you knew you could get away with it? Number 14, have you ever made out with a guy just because it seemed like the thing to do? Number 15, are you anxious to get out from under the control of your parents and gain your freedom to pursue any relationship you want? Number 16, do you go into websites or chat rooms that you know your parents would not approve of? Number 17, have you ever given your phone number or physical address to a stranger that you were flirting with over the internet without your parents' knowledge? Number 18, have you set rules or guidelines for your own sexual behavior or your relationships that you've already broken? Number 19, do you hide certain things, such as steamy love letters or magazines or videos? And then number 20, do you envision that getting married someday will be the answer to all your problems and will relieve you of all your sexual and emotional temptations? If so, you are fighting a battle, and it's only going to intensify until you look at these myths that are swimming around in your mind and you recognize the truths that will set you free. I want to share a passage of scripture with you from John 8, 31 and 32. Jesus is speaking to his disciples and he says, "If you hold to my teaching, then you are really my disciples. And then you will know the truth and the truth will set you free." In other words, if you're in any kind of bondage, the only thing that's going to set you free from that bondage is the truth. And so we're going to look at 10 myths that intensify sexual struggles for young women. And then we will also look at the truth that will set you free from those myths. And so the first myth is, I am mature enough to watch any movie or television show, read any book, listen to any music, or surf any websites without it affecting me in a negative way. This whole concept of we can compartmentalize what goes into our mind and keep that totally separate from our lives and from our relationships is the biggest farce. And you have to understand that is a complete and total myth. Don't unscrew your head and put it under the lazy boy recliner. God is just as concerned with your mental purity as He is with your physical purity. And understand that when you watch those sexy love scenes and read those scenes out of the romance novels and that sort of thing, what you're basically doing is you're rehearsing a part. And then when it comes your time to step up on stage and you have an opportunity how to respond to someone who is trying to initiate some sort of sexual activity, you're more than likely going to play the part exactly as you have rehearsed it. And if you have been just filling your mind full of all kinds of stuff where women are just allowing themselves to be swept up into this relationship and falling into bed with him, then it's going to make it a lot harder for you to stand firm and say, I'm not going there, okay? And so do be very careful about what you watch and what you listen to and what you put into your mind, because here's the truth. Being indiscriminate about what you feed your mind is not a sign of maturity. It's a sign of immaturity, okay? It doesn't make you older or more mature just because you watch rated R movies or something like that. It's a sign that you're really too immature to know that that's not good stuff to be putting in my brain, okay? And I remember during the days that I was experiencing all this sexual and emotional temptation and just feeling just this overwhelming pull in that direction, when I look back at what was going on in my life at that time, I was putting my babies down for their nap every day so I could sit down in front of the television and watch soap operas all afternoon. All my children, One Life to Live, General Hospital, boom, I'm there 3 hours a day. Well, is it any wonder that I was struggling with all these extramarital temptations? I mean, I just remember in so many of the soap operas that one of the main female characters, she's struggling. Does she stay faithful to her husband who doesn't really pay attention to her anymore? Or does she just allow herself to get swept up in this romance with this guy who just is all that in a bag of chips? You kind of start rooting for the affair when you're watching these soap operas. And that was what was beginning to operate in my heart. I was thinking, you know what? My husband does not meet my emotional needs. I'm going to go out and find somebody that I think is all that in a bag of chips. Well, duh. Once I stopped watching those soap operas and went through my counseling, it was amazing just the difference that it made and how well my heart could connect with my husband and not feel so drawn outside of our marriage relationship. And so be mature and guard your mind. Also, another passage out of Luke 6:45. The good woman brings good things out of the good stored in her, and the evil woman brings evil things out of the evil stored up in her heart. Another passage of scripture says it's out of the overflow of the heart that the mouth speaks. And so as long as we're storing up evil things, evil is going to wind up coming out of us eventually. But if we're storing up good things, it's going to be the good that comes out of us. It's very biblical. The second myth is how I dress, that's my business. That shouldn't be a concern for God or guys, my wardrobe. Well, I want to tell you a little story that I think is very illustrative of the fact that men do make a judgment of you based on what you are wearing. This particular day, I needed to go to the bank. And I packed up my son, who was 4 at the time, and he had a playmate over, Cameron. And so I said, Cameron, won't you come along with us? I'll take you to the playground afterwards, but let's go to the bank. So we arrived at the bank, and they were arguing over who had to be the bad guy and who got to be the good guy. And they were armed with a toy sword and a toy bow and arrow. And finally, I thought, we got to get in the bank, guys. Come on, let's go. I said, why don't you both be good guys and protect the bank from the bad guys? Well, they like that. So they go running into the bank with their little weapons, and one of them positions himself on one side of the door, and the other one positions himself on the other side of the door, and they are protecting the bank from the bad guys. And all the tellers and the people in the lobby, they were looking on at these little boys, and they were going, oh, that's so sweet. We feel so safe. Thank you for protecting us. And then through the other lobby doors, in walks a young woman dressed in a very short skirt and high heels and tight blouse and hair and makeup just so. And she struts her stuff going through that bank lobby. And everyone in the room is watching her and watching these little boys and watching her and watching. It was like watching a tennis match. They just kept going back and forth. And I could tell that they were wondering exactly what I was wondering. What do these two little boys think of her? Fortunately, Cameron waited until after the lady walked out the exit doors before he leans over to Matthew and pretty much explains how he feels. He says, the Bible warns about women like that. And I thought, wow, the fact that this little four-year-old guy recognizes that this is the kind of woman that the Bible warns about, that should speak volumes to young women, that we definitely don't want to portray ourselves as an evil seductress, because guys figure that out really, really quick, even four-year-old guys. So how you dress. Think that girls have to understand that they can be a real stumbling block for guys. Because those guys who don't recognize, ooh, that's a woman that the Bible warns about, what they perhaps are doing are kind of breaking their necks to look her direction. Because, I mean, hey, she's eye candy. She looks great, okay? And what happens is men are so visually stimulated that when they see something sexy like that, it creates like a chemical pop in their brain. And these chemical pops are very, very addictive to men. That's why pornography is so incredibly tempting, especially to men, to women too, but especially to men. And women, we don't understand this chemical pop and this visual stimulation thing. In all honesty, we can see a guy in a Speedo and go, oh, yuck, put on some clothes. But if a guy sees a woman in a bikini, he's not going, oh, yuck, put on some clothes. He's going, oh, wow, I don't want to be caught looking at her. And so understand that how we dress, what we wear, is either going to be a stumbling block to men or it's going to build them up and help them not to stumble and fall. As a matter of fact, I want to go over to a handout called Are You Dressing to Impress the Wrong Kind of Guys? Okay. And first of all, before we get into this little questionnaire, I want to read a couple of quotes from some very responsible young men who were just very honest with me about this whole how women dress thing and how it affects them. Nate, a college sophomore, he says, you know, guys wouldn't try so hard to pursue girls sexually if girls didn't dress like that's what they want. When guys see a girl wearing tight-fitting or revealing clothing, sure, it makes our babe radar go off and we take notice, but we're not thinking she's marriage material or anything. If a guy has integrity, he'll look away and ignore her. But if he doesn't, he's gonna pursue her, but for all the wrong reasons. So ladies, I think that's very important that we understand that that's the reality. And then Curtis, a high school senior, he said, it's really hard to focus on Jesus when I see a girl wearing a really tight shirt or low-rise jeans. I'm not trying to blame it all on girls, but I don't want a girlfriend who exposes herself to other guys by dressing immodestly. I want a girl who I can respect and who will respect the fact that I want to guard my eyes against lusting after her body before we're married. And so with that in mind, let's read through these questions that could determine if there are certain things in your closet that might need to be cleaned out. Number one, if your blouse buttons up, is it so tight that someone sitting beside you might get a glimpse through the gaps between the buttons as you move around? I think that it's a very cute fashion these days to wear a camisole under a button-up blouse, because sometimes you do turn certain ways that you do get kind of a clear shot through there. Well, if all they're seeing is a camisole, maybe that's not a big deal. But if they're seeing your bra or your breast, I would think that that could get a guy's motor revving. So by all means, make sure that your blouses don't fit that tightly. And if they are a little snug, then put on a camisole underneath. And then if someone is standing over you or you are bending over, could they get an eyeful of cleavage? Cleavage is basically the line that can be seen between your breasts when your shirt is too low cut, or when you have them pressed together like with a push-up bra and there's more coming out of your shirt than is in it. So we definitely want to be very sensitive. You know, move around. You know, do the things you would normally do in the course of a day. Bend over, pick something up. What is it that people are seeing as you move around in your clothes? It's not enough to look straight forward in a mirror and go, I look fine. I look modest. Move around in that, function in that, and see what it's going to do when other people are looking on. Third, are any of your tops so sheer that others can see the lace on your bra? You know, in today's day and age, underwear is outerwear. People like to be seen in their Victoria's Secret underwear. I think that your underwear should be kept more of a secret than people knowing that you shop at Victoria's Secret. And so make sure that your bra isn't on display for people through your sheer tops. And then, do any of your sleeveless shirts or tank tops reveal your bra straps or require that you not even wear a bra? That's definitely an issue. Guys are definitely going to notice that, okay? Do your shirts reveal any part of your abdomen or back? If you do, what I call the hallelujah test. The hallelujah test is if you raise your arms and praise to God, what's showing down here? Are they seeing skin? Are they seeing belly? Are they seeing that, you know, that little small of your back that is very arousing to men? If so, your shirt's not long enough, okay? Or wear another shirt underneath that you can kind of tuck in. Do any of your shirts have sexually suggestive slogans, such as sexy or flirt? I'll never forget the first day of sixth grade for my daughter. I pulled up in front of the junior high, and I'm thinking, oh, it's so sweet how you see all these kids, and they're dressed in their, you know, brand new back-to-school outfits, and everybody looks so spiffy and everything. But this one young girl, she comes walking up the sidewalk, and she's got this skin-tight black T-shirt on that says flirt across the chest. And I'm thinking, what kind of impression is that going to give your teachers on the first day of school? And what kind of impression is that going to give the young men that you go to school with? And what kind of impression is that going to give your girlfriends, you know? And so those sexually suggestive slogans, I think that they need to remain off our clothing. Are any of your jeans so tight that someone could read the date on a dime in your pocket? Or like my mother used to say, do they look like that you were melted and poured into them? Or that they were sprayed on? Are they that tight? Do you have to lie down on the bed and suck in your stomach to zip up any of your pants? Are they that tight? Do your jeans ride your hips so low that your underwear could be seen from the back? I will never forget the day that I was in the Galleria at Dallas, and I was walking through a JCPenney store, and I saw this ad in the lingerie department, and it was of a woman's backside, and she had low-rise jeans on, and you could see her thong underwear coming out of the top. And I thought, that's totally inappropriate. And then I thought, well, they can't show her whole body in a thong to advertise thongs, so I guess this is just their way of trying to advertise appropriately, but surely no woman would ever do that. But then I went to the food court, and as I was sitting there eating my Wendy's hamburger, across the aisle walks this teenage girl wearing low-rise jeans with a thong hanging out the top. And I thought, oh my gosh, what is this world coming to? And then the very next Sunday, I was taking my children to Awana's, and I walked into the church, and I saw a mom bending over to take care of one of her children, and there, lo and behold, were low-rise jeans with a thong hanging out the top. And I thought, if you can't even go into the church and not see this kind of a thing, gosh, you know, what kind of world are we living in? And so I think it's very important. I'm not attacking girls who like to wear thongs. I know that, you know, they think that they can be very, very comfortable. I personally think, you know, that's I can't imagine how that would be more comfortable, but more power to you. I'm not saying it's wrong to do that, but just make sure that it's not on display for anybody to see when you're bending over. Men don't need to have that information. That's a little too much information for a guy to have, knowing that you wear a thong. Let's see, and do you own pants that have lettering or graphics across the seat to draw attention to your rear view? Sometimes you see this on little junior high girls. It has cheer right across her bottom, and I'm thinking, I think that's just kind of your way of wanting people to look that direction. Do your skirts or shorts come above your thumbnail when your arms are at your side? Okay, that would be way too short. Back up to a full-length mirror and bend over to touch your toes. Are your private parts or your panties on display in this position? Again, it's important to move around and look at what other people are going to be seeing. Do any of your skirts ride excessively high above the knee when you are seated? Because, ladies, the whole idea of, oh, well, I'll just keep my legs crossed when I'm wearing this short skirt so no one will see anything. We don't always remember to cross our legs. And so if your skirt is that short, it's too short. When you are wearing a particular skirt, could someone sitting or standing in front of you catch a glimpse of your panties or upper thigh if you fail to keep your legs crossed? Regardless of the length of your skirts, do you have any slits up the front or the back or the side that could draw a guy's eye a little too far up your leg? If you choose to wear thong underwear, does the waistband show when you squat down or bend over, like I mentioned earlier? And then finally, do you have bras that you like to wear just because you know the pretty straps will show when you wear certain tops? And so I would encourage you to share this little checklist with all your girlfriends as well, because I'm sure that you have noticed that Some of our friends can kind of push the envelope and dress outside of an appropriate boundary without even recognizing it. I know that me, in my 20s, my best friend came over to me after leading and directing a summer camp with me. And she said, "Shannon, I have to tell you that, you know, you're standing up there and you're teaching these youth all about modesty and propriety and stuff, but," she said, "I don't think you realize how short your shorts are." And I was like, "What are you talking about? You know, these are like, you know, my mom's shorts." But she said, "Turn around and bend over." And I did that, and I was like, "Oh my gosh." And I was, but I didn't do that, did I? Did I? And, you know, Lisa was like, "Well, I don't know if you did that or not, but they're too short." So, you know, listen to your friends and be the kind of friend that will speak the truth in love to another person. If they ask you, "Does this look inappropriate on me?" If it does, tell them. Or even if they don't ask, if it looks inappropriate, speak the truth in love and say, "I don't know if you realize, you know, how much is showing there, what kind of impression you might be giving guys, but I know your heart well and I know your character. And this outfit is not reflective of that godly character." Okay? And so moving on, oh, and incidentally, I like to mention this just because I think it's cute. You know, there is a verse in the Bible that says that sin is bound to come, but woe to those through whom it comes. It would be better that they have a millstone tied around their neck than to cause a brother to stumble and fall. Now, I don't know about you, but that millstone necktie sounds really uncomfortable compared to just modest clothes, okay? So know that it is a concern for God. It's not just a concern for guys. It is a concern to God how you dress. So the third myth is flirting's okay. Well, hello. I looked up the definition of flirting in Webster's Dictionary, and what it says is to behave amorously, which means like you're wanting love, without serious intent. Another word that could be used, and it was right there in the dictionary, is to tease someone. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't like to be teased. I remember my older brother teasing me nonstop, and it would just make me so angry. And I watched my son teasing my daughter. "I got the last popsicle, Erin. Don't you want it? Na, 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 na." And then he pulls it away, and oh, it makes her so mad. She just wants to reach out and grab that popsicle from him, you know, bang him over the head with it or something. Nobody likes to be teased. And what we're doing when we flirt with guys is we send them the message that this is what I want from you. But then when they try to give it and you're just like, "Oh, no, no," and you know, you play the tease, what happens is guys can get very aggressive. They don't like to be teased any more than I did or that my daughter did. And oftentimes they'll want to do what Erin did with that popsicle. They'll want to just reach out and take what it is that you were flaunting in front of their face. That is how date rape situations happen. That is exactly what happened to me. I flaunted myself in front of his face, and I wound up, you know, paying a very hefty price for that which I aroused in him. Because the male sex drive is also very connected to a certain level of aggression. And when they get very aroused, they can get very aggressive. And so it's very important for young women to understand the difference between the word "no" with a question mark at the end and "no" with an exclamation point at the end. You know, when a guy is putting his arm around her and maybe he's trying to slip his hand down her shirt or run his hand up her thigh or something like that, there's a big difference between, "Oh, no, no, don't stop." You know, what he's hearing is, "Don't stop, don't stop," because she's just kind of a little iffy about the whole thing. But if she stands up and says, "No, I'm not playing that game. Homie, don't play that. You are going to stop or else you can't be in relationship with me. That we can go outside, we can shoot hoops, we can go to the mall, we can go make a pizza in the kitchen, whatever, but we're not playing that game here on the couch." If she sends him that message loud and clear, he will respect her boundaries. And if not, she needs to kick him out by the curb before the next trash pickup. Okay? He's got to respect her no. Myth number four. I need to have a boyfriend to feel as if I am somebody. And having a boyfriend will solve all my problems. How many of you have known young women that that's like their goal in life is just to find a boyfriend, and they just feel so incomplete until they find a boyfriend? You know, that whole Jerry Maguire thing of, "Oh, you complete me." That's a bunch of malarkey. That makes me want to just gag kind of thing. No person can complete another person. A healthy relationship is not the union of two incomplete people that make one complete unit. A healthy relationship is the union of two complete people who just come together to form a more synergistic union. Two people who need each other and are needy of one another, it's basically like two ticks and no dog. They just latch onto each other and just kind of suck the life out of each other. You know, but there's nothing healthy there to feed off of, you know? And so know that having that boyfriend is not going to make you feel as if you are somebody. And having that boyfriend is not going to solve all your problems. Here's the truth. If you think that you need a boyfriend, you are not ready for a boyfriend. A good relationship is more about becoming the right person than finding the right person. And so rather than spending all your energies out there looking for Mr. Right, why don't you focus on becoming Mrs. Right? Okay, focus on the things that you want to do and become and accomplish and work on so that when you do find a guy, you're just a much healthier, more complete human being. Okay? Myth number five, guys want basically the same thing from dating relationships that girls want. Now, girls probably wouldn't say that they believe this myth, but what's operating in their mind as they're flirting around and trying to emotionally connect with these guys is they're operating under the assumption that the guy is going to be just as satisfied with that level of involvement. But guys want more. That's not necessarily a bad thing. It's the way that God designed guys. Here's the truth. The big difference between guys and girls is that guys give love to get sex. It's not a bashing statement. That's just the way that God made them. But that girls give sex to get love. And this can be a very dangerous combination. And you can imagine that in a marriage, this combination actually works very well. He gives her love so he can have sex. She gives him sex so she can have love. They're meeting each other's needs. It's just a beautiful cycle that just keeps going on and on and on. But in a dating relationship, it can be very, very destructive. That he just says the things that he thinks she wants to hear just so she'll let down her guard and he can get what he wants. And she just, you know, goes on with it because she thinks, oh, but he loves me and we'll probably get married someday. And maybe this will be the way to secure his love. Very dangerous combination. And I also want to highlight just a few other differences between guys and girls. Number one, guys are driven by their physical desires, whereas girls are driven by their emotional desires. This is just the way that God made them. Guys crave physical intimacy, whereas girls crave emotional intimacy. Guys are stimulated by what they see, whereas girls are stimulated by what they hear and feel. That's why a guy who says all the right things can sure float her boat and get her to let her guard down. And once she gives her heart to him, her body is right there wanting to follow after it. And then finally, a guy's body can disconnect from his mind, heart, and spirit. However, a girl's mind, heart, body, and spirit are very intricately connected. And once she bonds physically with him, she feels, and it's like a Velcro thing. I mean, she is attached to this guy. And it really, really hurts when he pulls away from her. And you know, you think about this whole thing of guys being visually stimulated and women being emotionally stimulated. And yeah, it's actually a very beautiful thing. It can actually be traced way back to the Garden of Eden when God made the first man and the first woman. You can imagine that if all Adam wanted to do was to walk and talk and hold hands and pick flowers like Eve, he would have never really gotten around to wanting to have sex, which is basically what the Lord had told them to do. What commandment did God give them? Be fruitful and multiply, increase in number and fill the earth. And what does that mean? That means have sex and make babies. And so God had to place something in one of them that would cause them to want to be physical with one another. And he placed it in Adam in the form of visual stimulation. One look at Eve's body and he said, "Whoa, man." And that's how woman got her name. Whoa, man. That was Adam's response. And you can imagine if all Eve wanted to do was arm wrestle and play football and that kind of stuff, she wouldn't have been a very good mom. She wouldn't have been very nurturing. God placed in Eve the desire to nurture and to be emotionally connected with the children that she brings into the world. And that is a very beautiful picture. So it's not that men are pigs and women are frigid. It's that men are physically stimulated, women are emotionally stimulated, and together, that's a very beautiful, synergistic, God-honoring relationship. And we don't need to throw stones at each other or judge each other because one is different from the other. God intended it to be that way. He intended it to be a very complementary design. So moving on to myth number 6. Girls think, oh, but my love will save him. I can change him. And they'll date a really dysfunctional guy, thinking, oh, but he'll change for me. Well, you know, I think it's Dr. Laura who says this is one of the stupid things that women do to totally mess up their lives. You have to understand the truth that a girl's love does not change a broken guy's behavior. It only validates it. Her love says to him, you're okay, just the way you are. Okay, what incentive does a guy have to truly change if the girl has already entered into this relationship with him? I think the much more effective approach would be, well, you know, because you have this big issue over here, because you are rebelling against your parents, or because you look at pornography, or whatever the issue is, because that's going on in your life, I can't really be in relationship with you until after that is all worked out and you can assure me that that is something in your past. And if it continues to be a recurring thing, I'll know that you were lying to me. And so that is when he has incentive to change. If she agrees to be in relationship with him, he's like, well, hey, she loved me before, so keep on loving me. And he loses his motivation to change. And oftentimes, women, they want to be someone's savior. They really want to have this positive impact on a guy's life and be responsible for totally transforming his behavior. It's what I call the Messiah complex. Many other counselors call it the Messiah complex as well. It's a woman's desire to want to change a guy's behavior. But here's the thing, is that when you try to be a Messiah to someone and change someone, which is something that only God can do, what winds up happening is the same thing that happened to the real Messiah. He was crucified. And girls do get emotionally crucified in relationships with a broken guy. And so make sure that the guy that you choose to date doesn't need any type of a major character overhaul. Make sure that he is living the kind of life that you would want him to live if you were to choose to become his wife someday. Okay? So myth number 7, as long as we don't go all the way, I'm still sexually pure. Well, again, sex is more than just what you do. It's who you are. And I hate to rain on anyone's purity parade, but technical virginity is not really something to be all that proud of. It basically says, I have very little self-control and very little respect for myself or for my partner. Okay, so when you push the envelope and basically do everything except intercourse, I think that's a pretty marginal definition of purity, because again, purity is more a state of your mind, your heart, and your spirit in addition to your body. So the truth is, technical virginity does not equate to sexual purity. Okay, so what I encourage young people to do is, rather than, you know, doing everything except going all the way, see how much you can save for marriage, okay? It's kind of like a bomb. You know, if you know that a bomb is going to go off, you're not over here going, now how close can I get to this thing without getting hurt? What you're asking is, how far away from that do I need to be in order to be safe? And that's what you need to be asking in relationships, is how much can I save for marriage so that I don't get caught up in the destructiveness of what could result, okay? And one of the things that I strongly recommend that all people, not just young people, save until marriage is, of course, any type of body caressing. You know, a lot of women think, well, I'm not letting him touch me below the belt, so we're okay. But they don't understand that, no, when a woman has her breasts fondled, that is a very sexually arousing thing, and her guard can go way down very quickly. But another thing is French kissing. You know, a lot of teenagers or, you know, whoever think, oh, well, we're just kissing, it's no big deal. But you have to understand that French kissing is designed to get your sexual juices flowing. There's just no other way to put it. You know, there's a reason that you don't French kiss your mother or your grandfather, because that is designed to be a very sexual sort of a kiss. It's really considered foreplay to sexual activity. And so I'm not saying that you're going to hell in a handbasket if you know, give your boyfriend or your girlfriend a kiss, you know, a little peck on the cheek, or, you know, an appropriate expression of affection in that way. But when it turns into deep, passionate kissing, what my dad called tonsil hockey or swapping spits, you're basically playing with fire. You are stirring something up in one another that is going to be very hard to fulfill in a righteous way until after you are married. And so I would encourage you, save French kissing and any type of body caressing until after the wedding ceremony. So moving on to myth number 8, and we touched on this earlier, masturbation does not hurt me or my relationship with my future husband or my relationship with God. You know, self-touching can begin early in life. It can become a habit long before a girl understands its long-term effects. You know, at Teen Mania, where I teach on a regular basis, what girls often say to me is, you know, I just can't even remember how young I was when I started touching myself, and I never really realized it was a big deal until I came to Teen Mania and started living in a dorm situation and realized this would not be appropriate for me to engage in masturbation with 6 other roommates in the room, but that she finds it so difficult to stop the behavior that she realizes it's become an addiction for her. And that's what young people need to understand, that masturbation, while it's far from the unpardonable sin, can definitely become a habit that is so addictive that even after you get married, it's hard to give it up, let alone when you're in a college dorm room. But you know, oftentimes I will get emails from married people saying, I just can't surrender control. I can't just let my partner bring me to orgasm. It just doesn't work for me. I'm just so used to doing this for myself. And I feel as if I'm having to tell my partner, well, you know, you'll have to stop there. I'll have to take it from here. Or they separate themselves into solitary masturbation and they engage in sexual pleasure outside of their marriage relationship. Know that this is not what God intended. God intended for sexual pleasure to be shared between a husband and a wife, not for you to focus on yourself to the point that you become a selfish lover, but for you to be so interested in fulfilling your spouse's sexual pleasure that, you know, what you get out of the deal isn't really as much of a concern as just that you are pleasuring your partner. That is what making love is really all about. And so masturbation can definitely train your body to fly solo. We do teach our body as to what it finds pleasurable. And if we are teaching our body that what is most pleasurable to you is solo self-stimulation, then that is not going to change when you put the wedding band on your finger. And so the truth is, the habits that you create as a single person are the same habits that you carry into marriage. Okay? So hopefully we can save even sexual pleasure until the marriage relationship, because that's where it's intended, and that's where the ultimate fulfillment will be found. And also 1 Thessalonians 4:3-5 says, it is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control her own body in a way that is holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the heathen who don't even know God. Okay, so sexual self-control will serve you well when you are facing sexual temptations prior to marriage. You know, if you can't even say no to yourself in the privacy of your own bedroom, what hope do you have when some sweet-talking hunk of a man tries to talk you into lowering your guard? Okay, so exercising that sexual self-control alone is very, very key to exercising sexual self-control when you're with a partner. The 9th myth is, well, I feel so sexually tempted, I must already be guilty, so why bother resisting? But the truth is, Satan's favorite strategy to use is false guilt. There is no sin in being tempted. So when you're tempted, you can't say, oh, well, you know, I'm already guilty, because, you know, there is a passage in Scripture that says that even Jesus was tempted, yet we know Jesus was sinless. So that tells us that temptation and sin are two different things, and you can be tempted, but it doesn't mean that you have to sin. And that's exactly what Jesus faced. In Hebrews 4:15-16, it says, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who was tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Now, most young people will say, oh, well, sure, he was tempted in every way except sexually, because he was Jesus and he was the Son of God. Well, hello, the Bible says he was human in every way. He was the Son of Man. And the Bible says he was tempted in every way, and it doesn't have a parenthesis that says except sexually. And you know, you think about it, not only was Jesus a man in every sense of the word, with the exception of sinfulness, He was being followed around from town to town by beautiful women who were taking care of him out of their own financial means. I mean, they were passionate about this guy. I mean, they were washing his feet with their tears and drying his feet with their hair. And I think that they would have pretty much done anything for Jesus. And I'm sure that some of them may have had the thought, it'd be really great just to have 10 minutes alone with him because he's just such a wonderful guy. You know, but only in Scripture one time is it mentioned that Jesus was ever alone with a woman, and that was the woman at the well. And the purpose was to convict her, was to confront her with her sin. And the Bible says that she was so transformed by the experience that she went running back to her hometown, and the difference was so evident in her life that many other people became a believer in Jesus as a result. So obviously nothing sexually inappropriate happened. And I don't care what the Da Vinci Code says, Jesus was not sexually involved with Mary Magdalene, okay? And so, yeah, the whole thing with temptation and sin and them being two totally separate things, we have to understand that even though it's not a sin to be tempted, we do have a responsibility to avoid temptation when we can. That whole thing of a moth being drawn to a flame. Well, just because a moth is drawn to a flame doesn't mean that he's as good as dead. But when he enters into that flame, that's when he is destroyed, and it's that temptation that leads him there. And so we have to learn to work against that temptation. Another analogy I like to use is a lion. You know, so often women will like basically tiptoe into the lion's den and stick their head in the lion's mouth and be like, oh Lord, save me from the lions. And I can envision God up there going, excuse me, I think that you could have done a little bit better a job at avoiding those lions altogether if you weren't so curious. You know, just got to see what's in there. Just got to see how this feels. And oh Lord, this feels tempting. Help me, help me. Well, the Lord is there for you in your time of need. But let's don't use that as a driver's license to just jump into the lion's den and stick our head in that lion's mouth. Okay? Let's be a little bit more responsible. And then finally, the tenth myth. Well, there's no one who would really understand my struggle. So many young people live such destructive lifestyles because they, just like me, felt as if they didn't have anyone who would really understand. They didn't feel as if they had anyone that they could talk to. And you know, in hindsight, that was so not true in my life. My parents loved me like crazy. I could have talked to my mom. I could have talked to my dad. I could have talked to my brother. I could have talked to my youth pastor. There were plenty of people that I could have talked to, but I just felt so alone in this struggle. And that's another big myth is, oh, but I'm the only one struggling with this. I remember actually thinking in my early 20s, there must be something wrong with me because, you know, I've always heard how sexual temptations are a man's issue. And I wonder if, like, when I was conceived, that there was just more testosterone than estrogen in how I was made. And maybe I just have a male sex drive and no other woman has this. And so surely no other woman would understand. And yeah, that was very destructive thinking, you know, for me to feel as if, oh, I'm the only one. So stop thinking that you're the only one and that no one would understand. Because the reality is that we all struggle with sexual integrity to some degree. Now, the illustration that we use in the book is imagine a bell curve where you have a population of people, and on one extreme, you have maybe 10% of the population who, you know what, they are as pure as the driven snow. I mean, they are like June Cleaver, and she would never dream of looking at anybody but Ward, okay? But then on the other end of the spectrum, you have the Playboy Bunny type of girl, the Anna Nicole Smiths of the world, who just have no sense of shame or modesty or anything else when it comes to being seductive with men. But then you have about 80% of women that are somewhere in the middle of all that, who struggle with sexual integrity by varying degrees. And so please don't ever feel as if you're alone in this struggle. Although Satan would love for you to feel as if you are alone, but you're not. Because here is the truth from 1 Corinthians 10:13. No temptation has seized you but what is common to woman. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. And what way out does God usually provide? Does He turn your sex drive off altogether so you can just kind of go through life without facing these temptations? Does He totally take it away when you become a Christian or fast and pray for 24 hours straight or put the wedding band on your finger or have children? No. What He usually does in the way of helping you stand up under it is he provides an accountability relationship. And that requires that you step out in faith and divulge your confidence with someone that you feel as if you can trust. In all honesty, I was so thankful for the day that a female pastor friend of mine pulled me aside and said, "Shannon, I don't think that you understand the effect that you're having on men by the way that you dress, by the way that you act, by the way that you walk, by the way that you talk." And she shared with me, she wasn't just throwing a stone at me. She wasn't just trying to convict me of sin. She went on to explain her own personal testimony. Now, this is a woman that I thought was rock solid. I mean, she was a female ordained pastor. I thought she just had it all together. But she explained to me that much earlier on in her marriage, she had struggled with an extramarital affair, one that she actually fell into, and that she locked herself up in her bedroom with the full intention of committing suicide because she felt so devastated by what she had done to her marriage, and that God in His loving mercy reached His long arm of grace down to her and pulled her out of her pit of self-destruction, and He set her feet on solid ground. And I thought, wow, if God can do that for her when she went all the way, surely He can do that for me when I'm just really struggling. Okay? Not that I didn't go all the way in forming very unhealthy emotional bonds with men, but I thought, if God is big enough to save her, then surely God is big enough to save me. Because really, when we say that, oh, well, you know, God probably could never forgive me for this, what you're really saying isn't as much a reflection of who you think you are, that you're just this wretched, simple person, as much as what you're saying is that God is not big enough to rescue me, that the blood that Jesus shed on the cross, that's not enough to cover me of my sins, that I have to have some special miracle to set me free. And nothing could be further from the truth, because we all know as Christians that what Christ did on the cross is enough for all of our sins combined, that none of us have ever done anything that the Lord cannot and will not forgive us for. And so, you are not alone in your struggle. Seek accountability, and the Lord's mercy and grace is enough. It is sufficient to sustain you and set your feet on more solid ground, and perhaps even exalt you to a position of authority in other women's lives, like Pam was for me, and just give you the opportunity to speak into a younger woman's life, the same way that God has given me these opportunities to speak into younger women's lives. Do that. Consider starting your own Every Young Woman's Battle group. You'll be amazed at how many women will come out of the woodwork just because they finally feel as if they have a safe place to interact. A lot of women have told me that they went to Sex and Love Addicts Anonymous groups feeling as if that might be a safe place, but when they found that it was often a co-ed group, that made about as much sense as an alcoholic going to a bar for an AA meeting. You know, that just to be in the presence of men wasn't the healthiest thing for them with their struggle, but to find a group of women who are willing to take off their masks and be real with one another and not backstab and not whisper and gossip and not throw a stone, but just to reach out and lovingly say, "Oh, I understand what you're struggling with, and I don't judge you or condemn you. And I'm here for you. I will encourage you. I will pray for you. I will hold you accountable. I'll call you every day if you need me to. But I'm not going to let you stumble and fall into this sexual affair without a fight." That's the kind of friend that every woman needs who is struggling in this battle. In John 14:15-17, Jesus says something very interesting that I think that we all need to just write on our hearts and remember forever and ever. He says, "If you love me, you will obey what I command." In other words, with love automatically comes obedience. We can't expect that God thinks that we love Him, but yet we're living this totally separate lifestyle like I did, this double life. He says, no, if you love me, you will obey my commands, because in reality, His commands are intended to protect us. He established these boundaries because He knew that the way that He designed the human body wasn't that we could have sex with anybody that we wanted and not pay huge physical consequences through STDs or unplanned pregnancies or infertility or whatever. He knew that the human body is designed to bond with one person and one person only. And He said, "I want to make sure that you are guarding, you know, above all else, your heart," because I think He knew that women, once they let their hearts go somewhere, their body's going to want to follow. But He established these boundaries and He said, "If you love me, you'll obey these. If you love yourself, you'll obey these. And if you love your future husband, you will obey these. There's a lot can be read into that passage of Scripture. And he says, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor who will be with you forever, the Spirit of truth, not the spirit of myth, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him, the Spirit of truth, because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives within you, and he will be with you. We need to understand that as Christians, we have the Spirit of truth living inside our hearts. And if we will listen to that still small voice that says, warning, you are about to make a wrong turn. Warning, this does not feel right. That is the Spirit of truth saying to you, excuse me, I have a much better choice for you. Won't you reconsider this before you really blow it here? That is an advantage that Christians have over non-Christians. And so the fact that the statistics are the same between Christians and non-Christians, that there are just as many failed marriages and just as much unfaithfulness going on in this world among Christians as there is among non-Christians, there's no excuse for that. Because we do have the Spirit of truth who lives in us and will be with us and will help us to say no. Not just no, but no in the face of those kinds of temptations. And so in closing, I want to share with you an analogy that I hope you will find helpful in just being patient and knowing that sex really is worth the wait. When you get to the end of your life and you hopefully die of natural causes, how old do you hope to be? If you're like most young women, they will say, well, I want to be at least like 90 or 100. And so let's just imagine a timeline that represents your life. Remember timelines from math class? Let's just say that over here was where you were born. And every step I take is a new decade of your life. And so if here is where you were born, this is 10 years old, and this is 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. This is representative of your entire life. And you may think, now, Shannon, you know, this whole thing of saving sex all the way until I'm married, that's pretty unrealistic expectation. I don't know if I can wait that long. Like it feels like it's forever or something. Well, here's the reality. Chances are you're maybe 15, 16, 17 years old. Okay, well, on your timeline, you would be 10, about here. And all I'm asking you to do is to save sex from today until about right here, just this far. And then look at all of these years of great sex that you can enjoy with your husband without guilt, without remorse, without regret, without STDs, without unplanned pregnancies, without infertility. There is so many years of joy and fulfillment and pleasure to be had if you can just wait from here to here. So let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the precious gift that you have given to us in our sexuality. And we acknowledge that it is because of lack of knowledge that many of us have already perished in many ways. But we thank you that you are a God, that when you died on the cross, you didn't say, forgive them for their sins, except for the sexual ones. Those are too big. I'm not dying for those. That what you did for us on the cross is enough to cleanse us of all sexual immorality in our past. And your grace is sufficient to protect us from all sexual immorality that we may be tempted by in the future. So Lord God, I lift these young women up to you, and I pray that you would strengthen their minds and their bodies and their hearts and their souls, and they would catch your vision for just how precious it is to save their sexual activities until marriage, that you would give them the strength to do so and the desire to do so, and that you would reward them abundantly, Lord, with happy, healthy, strong marriage relationships and beautiful, beautiful children. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Well, Shannon, thanks so much. Before we go, though, I do want to talk about some resources that you have. First, there's Every Young Woman's Battle, which is a much more in-depth than today's presentation. If you want to go a little bit deeper, we encourage you to check out that resource. And then there's also Every Woman's Battle. And then finally, there's their newest book called Every Woman, Every Day daily devotional. Tell us something about that, Shannon.
You know, I was a little encouraged, but on the same hand, I was a little disheartened when I would get emails from women saying, I love your book so much that I've started reading it as my daily quiet time. And I thought, whoa, if you're going to read any book every day, it better be God's book, not mine. And so we created this daily devotional that just took excerpts out of Every Woman's Battle, Every Young Woman's Battle, some other books in the series, and added scriptures and prayers so that you could be connecting with God every day of the year. It's 365 readings.
And again, that's Every Woman, Every Day Daily Devotional. For any of these resources, you can check it out and go to shannonetheridge.com. That URL is up on your screen, and we encourage you to visit that site. I want to thank the studio audience for joining us. I want to thank everybody around North America for watching us today. And Shannon, I want to thank you. Would you join me in thanking her?
Thank you.
We'll see you next time.
Bye-bye.